Hello, everybody. I would like to welcome everybody back for the first panel of the morning that is going to be really offering us a very important and worldwide use reference point to our discussions. I'm very pleased and honored to chair this panel, and I think we have a wonderful setup for the launch of the conference from an expert point of view. We have, as a leading presentation to start the discussion, among us, Maria van der Hoeven. We're honored to have her in Bratislava at this wonderful series of conferences from the International Energy Agency. And I think the presentation that we will be listening to is really going to give us the necessary pillars for understanding the reality and for approaching the big questions. As we learned from the lessons of the 2009 crisis in Central Europe, we set out to increase interconnectivity and promote the diversification of routes and sources in the region with lesser or more varying degrees of success. The goals of the European Union energy policy of security, supply, competitiveness, and sustainability, and the key objective of completing the internal energy market by the end of 2014 also seem to promote our common goals. But over the last year, the course of events in Ukraine have underlined, really, that we were identifying the key problems correctly. It is the vulnerability of Central Europe in terms of energy supply security, but it also created a whole new strategic framework for our discussions on energy security. And so this is the time now to ask the right questions from each other, and I believe the panel is going to offer you answers to these questions. Have we been setting the European Union energy policy on the right track to tackle these challenges? Was the deadline only wrong by identifying 2014 as the completion of the internal energy market? Or do we need to change directions or change priorities to achieve that goal as well? Or do we only need to focus more on the priorities in this venture, especially in the run-up to the 2015 Paris Summit on Climate Change? With this, I would like to, these big questions, obviously, that we're all trying to answer, I would like to give the floor to Maria van der Hoeven, who is, as Executive Director of the International Energy Agency, steered the agency during a period of exceptional change in the global energy economy. The IAEA has also been challenged by rapidly shifting supply and demand balances for oil as well as the other major fuels. At the same time, the global energy economic crisis had put a strain on resources. Our main speaker and presenter this morning led a strategic reorganization of the agency in 2012 and made it really capable of confronting contemporary energy challenges. As a result, I think we have been saying over the years, but we're more likely to say that the analyses that come out from the World Energy Report are really sort of offering the basic pillars for our work in everyday life as well in our various institutes and governments. In addition to this, however, she's been very much focused on another important access of energy questions, to provide the 1.3 billion people worldwide who currently lack energy resources with the needed energy for their development. As such, as a fundamentally important effort to reach that, Mrs. van der Hoeven has been invited to serve on the advisory board of the UN Sustainable Energy for All initiative, and I think it is also a tremendous and historic work that will have to be tackled in the years to come. So we're honored to have you here among us, and we're very pleased to listen to the presentation. Thank you.
First of all, thank you very much for your kind introduction. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be with you today to participate in this annual conference. And energy is understandably high on the agenda for Central European countries and Europe more generally. and we collectively face major challenges with respect to energy security, economic competitiveness, and climate. Now, this morning, we have heard a fruitful discussion about the achievements to date and future projects and prospects for regional energy cooperation between Central European countries to address these challenges. And during the next 25 minutes, I would like to put this in a broader global context by sharing the findings of the IEA's World Energy Outlook 2014. But first, two reminders. The first is World Energy Outlook is a set of three long-term scenarios based on a number of assumptions. But the moment the assumptions change, there are unexpected events, or there will be new policies the day after tomorrow, then the outcome of the scenarios might be different. And my second point is that for the first time, World Energy Outlook has an enlarged time horizon. It's 2040. It was 2035 before. Before diving into the projections of this year's outlook, let's start with where we are today. And I'm sorry, I've got some problems with the... with the video presentation. Now, much of the current focus on energy is on markets, markets that appear well supplied. But this calm should not divert our attention from the difficulties that we may face on the road ahead. We have seen turmoil in Iraq, and that has not disrupted the country's oil exports, that's true. But taking a long-term view, there is a risk that current instability would deter investment and, as a result, cause shortfall in oil supply. And likewise, natural gas supply appears ample, but geopolitics is creating uncertainty about the future outlook, especially in Europe, where debate has been renewed over whether and how to reduce reliance on Russia. So when we survey the global energy landscape, we see that energy security concerns are not diminishing. If anything, we expect them to rise up the agenda. This isn't doing anything. So, which one? I'm sorry, dear friends. Okay, good. And there are also unmistakable signs of strain alongside a few positive trends on the environmental and climate change front. On the one hand, we have seen several recent policy efforts which can help to reduce CO2 emissions, such as the historic climate announcement that was recently made by China and the United States, the two largest global CO2 emitters. And on the other hand, CO2 emissions continue to rise. And last year, yet, saw another record level of CO2 emissions, which were up 2.6%. And then there are the subsidies to fossil fuels. They also remain a big problem. Their value rising to almost $550 billion last year. And that is more than four times the amount provided to renewable energy. Fortunately, we are seeing results from an increasing emphasis on energy efficiency. In the European Union, for example, oil demand in road transport has fallen back to 1997 levels, even though sales of passenger cars have continued to rise. So there is evidence that policies can positively shape energy trends, but no certainty that sufficient action will be taken in the time required to get the world's energy system onto a more sustainable path. So the critical question is, will future changes in global energy be led by policies, by policymakers, or will they be driven by events? So let's look at our analysis to try and find an answer to this question. Global energy demand has grown by one-third since 2000. And in the OECD countries, energy demand has changed little in the last decade. Growth instead has been driven entirely by non-OECD countries, notably China, which has accounted for nearly half of the global increase since 2000. Looking out to 2040, we expect continued stable energy demand in OECD countries. But this hides something. This hides important changes in the energy mix. Demand for coal and oil continues to fall, while natural gas and renewable uses expands very rapidly. And in the European Union, natural gas becomes the leading energy source. In China, demand grows slow significantly through the 2020s and reaches a plateau due to the combined effects of energy efficiency measures, a maturing economy, and eventually a slightly declining population. So there are other countries to assume China's role as the engine of global energy demand growth. India today has a similar level of income per capita as China had 10 years ago, but has energy use per capita is around half China's level at the time, and that indicates a very significant growth potential. Energy demand development is one thing, but let's have a look at another key issue, energy costs and economic competitiveness. And that's an issue of deep concern for the European Union and particularly the countries of Central Europe, where there is a concentration of export-oriented heavy industry and manufacturing. This issue has received considerable public attention in recent years, with international oil prices having persistently above $100 per barrel until falling back just recently to below 80. And we have also seen the opening up of large disparities in natural gas prices between regions. Now, if one takes all end-use energy prices and weights them by energy consumption, one can measure an economy's average cost per unit of energy used. And when we do this, we see significant gaps between different economies. The average cost of energy has risen sharply in OECD countries during the last decade, closely mirroring international fuel price developments. So the United States has been partly shielded from this because of access to cheap shale gas. And today, the average cost of energy paid by consumers in the European Union is about 80% above the level in the United States. And in the period to 2040, the average cost of energy in the European Union increases, albeit slightly, with increasing fuel and electricity prices. And the differences among the regions, as you can see, persist. Now, the question is, what does this mean for national and regional economic competitiveness? Regions with relatively high energy costs, such as the European Union, but also Japan, face contracting exports of energy-intensive goods relative to lower-cost regions. And variations in energy costs have significant potential to influence investment decisions and company strategies in energy-intensive sectors such as chemicals, aluminium, cement, iron, and steel, and oil refining. So what can be done? Policymakers can reduce the impact of high energy costs on all sectors of the economy by promoting more efficient, competitive, and interconnected energy markets. And second, energy efficiency policies in particular have an important role to play. But if I were to highlight an overarching message for the European Union, it is that it must pursue energy and climate policies which are also cost-efficient, or they risk a deterioration of the region's competitiveness. Now let's have a look at oil. Markets are currently well supplied, and oil prices have come down. But short-term conditions should not divert our attention from problems that may lie ahead. And to understand why, we must take a longer view from problems that may lie ahead. In 2040, we expect that the world will use 104 million barrels a day of oil, and that's 14 million barrels a day more than now. And only a few regions show significant growth in oil supply over the next decades. It's the United States, it's Canada, it's Brazil, and the Middle East. And the rest of the world actually shows a net decline in output. And you can see how these key non-OPEC countries make a significant contribution to satisfy growing oil demand in the period to 2020. But after this, there's a large and growing gap in the market. And this gap needs to be filled by the only remaining large source of low cost, and that's the Middle East. There are plenty of resources to meet this challenge. The problem is not resources. But given the turmoil in parts of the Middle East today, there is real concern about a shortfall in investment. Now, you might think, well, there is plenty of time to sort this out. Extra supply from the Middle East is needed only in the 2020s. But that would be a mistake. To produce extra barrels in, let's say, 2025, we need to invest today, as it takes 7 to 8 years before a new oil field can produce at full capacity. Let me turn to gas. The conflict between Russia and Ukraine has once again raised concerns about natural gas supply security. Both in Central European countries, where nearly 80% of total gas demand is sourced from imports, mainly via pipeline from Russia, and of course in Europe more generally. There is concern about whether the system has the resilience to cope with a disruption to supply. And this is affected by an external dimension related to the availability of gas from alternative sources, or the same sources via different routes, as discussed this morning, as well as an EU domestic one. And that one is related to the functioning of markets, the adequacy of infrastructure, including gas storage. Is it enough? Is it resilient to deliver gas to consumers affected by a disruption? Now, in our projections, gas imports into Europe grow by 75% in the period to 2040. And additional suppliers enter the fold, notably from the Middle East and Caspian regions with the development of the Southern Gas Corridor, as well as some LNG from a fast-growing global LNG market. But even so, dependency on gas imports from Russia remains very high. So the practical question for Europe is how to manage this dependency. And in this respect, I have 5 points to note. First, efficient, competitive, and well-connected markets are generally the best guarantee for supply, for gas supply security. And in Europe, this means a well-functioning single market, enabling optimal utilization of storage and available LNG on a continental scale. Second, over the longer term, improving efficiency in the building sector, a major source of gas demand, is an underutilized and often overlooked way to improve security. And third, Europe can pursue continued development of its indigenous resources, including renewables, and where government chooses to encourage them, shale gas and nuclear. And four, it can also facilitate diversification of gas suppliers, both through commitment to a liquid and well-functioning LNG market, and also via coordinated support, including through foreign policy, financing and risk assistance, to upstream and pipeline developments, such as along the Southern Corridor. And finally, Europe can ensure that storage is capable of playing an emergency response role, instead of just a seasonal balancing one. The capabilities to switch away from gas use in the power sector is also an important option. But in Europe, that potential has been mostly exhausted. And that brings me to the often unloved source of energy, coal. Coal is generally abundant, affordable, and secure. But we expect its future use to be increasingly constrained by measures to tackle air pollution and reduce CO2 emissions. Global coal demand grows by 15% in the period to 2040, but almost two-thirds of the increase occurs during the next 10 years. Coal use in Europe, which peaked at 1987, has been on a long-term decline trend, and it will fall further in the period to 2040 because of a combination of factors that push the power sector toward alternatives. Policy support for low-carbon energy sources, retirements of aging coal-fired power plants, rising CO2 prices, and increasing international coal prices. The US coal demand follows a similar trend of decline. And coal will also be under pressure in China as the country looks to cap its share in the energy mix and consumption plateaus from the 2020s. What has become clear is that coal use is only compatible with climate goals with the rapid and widespread adoption of high-efficiency coal-fired generation technologies and in the longer term of carbon capture and storage, CCS technologies. And therefore, it's a prudent strategy to ensure that new coal-fired power plants are high-efficient and CCS-ready. And investments in these technologies from industry and policymakers, also in the EU, are critical to bring costs down. Now let me turn to the power sector, and there again we see changes in power generation underpinning a broader energy transformation. Almost 40% of current installed capacity worldwide reaches the end of its lifetime and is retired in the period to 2040. For the European Union, the share is almost two-thirds. Now on the one hand, these trends present a major challenge. Significant capacity must be added, both to replace plants that are retired and to meet new electricity demand. And worldwide, power generation capacity additions in the period to 2040 are greater than global installed capacity today. On the other hand, this offers a major opportunity to continue the transition to a low-carbon power sector, which is the main contributor to global emissions of greenhouse gases. Renewables account for over half of new power generation realized globally. Now, with the help of government subsidies, over 70% of capacity additions in the European Union are renewables-based, led by wind and solar PV. And the share of renewables in EU electricity generation consequently doubles to 46% in 2040. But you know, as the share of wind and solar PV in the power mix grows, their integration, both from a technical and market perspective, becomes more challenging. The technical challenges that arise from the variable nature of renewables can be addressed with increased investment in transmission across the region and between countries, and with the help of demand-side management practices and storage. And from a market perspective, ensuring electricity system reliability means that there will continue to be a fundamental need to build thermal power plants. There is, however, a risk that timely investment in such capacity will not be forthcoming in the European Union under current market rules, particularly for projects that rely on competitive wholesale prices to recover their costs. Encouraging new investment in thermal plants in Europe will require reforms to market design or electricity pricing that provide long-term signals for investment in capacity that contributes to the reliability and adequacy of the system. Now, each year, the World Energy Outlook includes a special focus on one energy source, and this time it is nuclear power, which is a critical source of electricity today in Czech Republic, Hungary, Slovak Republic, and is planned to be introduced in Poland. Around the world, the future of nuclear power is clouded by many uncertainties related to government policies, economics and financing of new builds, and public confidence issues. We project global nuclear capacity to rise by 60% to 2040, though this does not signal a nuclear renaissance. Its share of power generation, which peaked almost two decades ago, barely rises. But there is a divergence between Central Europe and the rest of the European Union in terms of the outlook for nuclear power. In Central Europe, we assume continued support for nuclear power. Poland introduces it to the mix, and elsewhere plants are under construction, are built, and plants which retire in the period to 2040 are going to be replaced. But in the European Union more broadly, capacity falls as much of the region looks to renewables and natural gas. Some countries phase nuclear out. And even with assumed lifetime extensions, half of EU nuclear capacity is retired in the period to 2040. And if lifetime extensions are not authorized and there are no new builds, EU nuclear capacity would fall to 5% of current levels in 2040. In Japan, Many of the plants that have been offline since Fukushima Daiichi are assumed to return to service. But capacity falls in the period to 2040 as a small number, just 4, of new builds does not offset the retirement of aging reactors. And the net increase in global nuclear capacity is concentrated. It's concentrated in just a few markets. United States, the largest user of nuclear power today, sees modest growth. Growth is more significant in India and in Russia. But what happens in China, which has 27 nuclear power plants under construction today, will determine the global trend. It accounts for 57% of the net increase in capacity, taking its nuclear capacity to almost 150 gigawatts in 2040, and making it the world's largest producer of nuclear power. Now, some countries are committed to maintaining nuclear power as part of their strategy to avoid CO2 emissions and to improve energy security. Today, nuclear is the world's second largest source of low-carbon electricity after hydropower. And in OECD countries, it's the largest source. Since 1971, we estimate it has avoided the release of 2 years of CO2 emissions at current rates. Nuclear will be critical to future energy sector decarbonization. By 2040, nuclear will have avoided almost 4 years of current emissions. But its role in limiting emissions can be naturally greater in some countries than in others. That brings me to energy security. In terms of energy security, nuclear represents a reliable source of baseload electricity generation. And it can also increase the diversity of power system. And for countries that might otherwise import energy to satisfy power generation needs, including those in Central Europe, it can reduce dependence on foreign energy supplies. And energy self-sufficiency is not necessarily a desirable goal. However, it does provide a very useful indicator of energy security. And as you can see in this slide, energy self-sufficiency can be enhanced by the use of nuclear power. And in the European Union, nuclear remains a key part of energy supply not derived from imports. But we all know that nuclear power also faces critical challenges, particularly with respect to public concerns. And if I could highlight just 2 focal points of public concerns, the first surrounds decommissioning nuclear power plants. Over the period to 2040, almost 200 aging reactors will be retired worldwide, which means dismantling the reactors and decontaminating and restoring the sites for future uses. We project this will cost around $100 billion in total. However, there is significant uncertainty about these costs and how long decommissioning projects will take. Regulators must therefore continue to ensure that adequate funds are set aside and that they are guaranteed to be available when needed. And the big question is, are countries, policymakers, regulators, utilities adequately prepared? My second point is the following. The massive surge in nuclear retirements also draws attention to the sharply increasing volume of high-level radioactive waste at reactor sites that will need to be safely stored, transported, and permanently disposed of. Finland, Sweden, France are more or less frontrunners to find solutions. And in the period to 2040, we project a cumulative amount of spent nuclear fuel that has been generated by nuclear power plants globally will double to more than 700,000 tons. This will need to be disposed of permanently to ensure its safe isolation over the very long time periods required for the radioactivity to decrease to background levels. But some 60 years after the first nuclear power plant started operation, no country has yet opened a permanent disposal facility for commercial high-level waste. And all countries that have ever produced radioactive waste are obligated to develop a solution for permanent disposal. Now, what do all these trends together mean for our 2 degrees Celsius target that countries have agreed to? The IPCC recently reminded us about the urgent need for taking action on climate and it concluded that the world has an overall CO2 emissions budget of around 2,300 gigatons. More than half of this emissions budget has already been used to date, which means that we have around 1,000 gigatons emissions left that we could emit to be compatible with a 50% chance of reaching the 2 degrees target. But if we continue on existing trends, then we will have used up the entire global CO2 budget by around 2040. And that implies that we could not emit any additional CO2 from 2040 onwards if we wanted to achieve the 2 degrees target. And that, of course, is not realistic. So the need to step up efforts in order to achieve the 2 degrees target is urgent. In 2013, the world has invested $400 billion in low carbon technologies. And the average annual investment in our central scenario, where we take account of existing and announced government plans, imply that average annual investment in these technologies is likely to be more than twice as high until 2040 than it was in 2013. So then we are talking about $900 billion per year. But this level of investment is still far enough. Reaching the 2 degrees target requires average annual investment in low carbon technologies of almost $1.6 trillion per year until 2040. And that's a level that is four times higher than what we are at investing today. So to facilitate this investment, a strong signal from the climate negotiators will be needed. Ladies and gentlemen, decision makers cannot afford to be complacent. We must recognize the signs of stress emerging in the energy system in the medium and long term and seize this window of opportunity to tackle them. Heightened geopolitical risk has drawn attention once more to gas security in Europe. And in the long term, Europe's gas imports are set to grow, with a decline of coal due to more stringent low-carbon regulation, as well as potential nuclear retirements. And yet, dependence on Russia is expected to persist, highlighting the importance of investing in an efficient, competitive, and well-connected gas market in Europe. To preserve electricity system reliability in Europe, it will be essential to encourage new investment in thermal capacity, accompanied by appropriate reforms to market design and electricity pricing. Nuclear. Nuclear power plays a major role in the electricity systems of Central Europe, offering important energy security and climate benefits. But if new builds are to be realized, governments will likely have to make a firm commitment to bring financing. And perhaps the most important sign of stress is the failure to transform the energy system quickly in time to stem the rise in energy-related CO2 emissions and preserve the 2 degrees target. Without clear direction from Paris in 2015, the 2 degrees goal will soon be out of reach for good. But in Europe, we should remember to pursue the most cost-efficient energy and climate policies so economic competitiveness does not deteriorate. Taking a step back and looking at Central Europe and Europe's energy system, it's clear that actions from well-informed policymakers, industry, and other stakeholders, both in the medium and long term, will be needed to steer it on a safer course. Thank you very much for your attention, and afterwards, of course, I'm fully prepared to take your questions.
Well, thank you very much for these insights and thought-provoking analyses. And with this, let me give the floor, the panel, this commentation and discussion to start. Our first commentator is going to be John Stau from the U.S. Energy Information Administration. John is the team lead for exploration and production in the Office of Petroleum, Natural Gas, and Biofuels Analysis. He leads analysis and modeling of U.S. domestic and international petroleum and natural gas resources and production for both short and long-term outlooks. He previously worked in the U.S. Department of Energy and in the White House Council of Economic Advisors in the International Energy Agency, And with this panel, I think we're going to have a very good coverage of the main sort of venues of analysis. US, the Commission, and the region is well represented in our panel, in addition to having a strong female component. So I'm very pleased to have that sort of extra color for this panel and honored to chair this. And John, the floor is yours as a minority speaker in this panel.
Thank you. At EIA, we're very focused on diversity also, so I feel right at home. Thank you for the invitation to come and speak with you today. It's a real pleasure to be here. The U.S. Energy Information Administration, EIA, is the statistical and analytical energy organization within the U.S. government. We are not a policy organization. We don't advocate for policy. Our role is to help policymakers, business, and consumers understand the options and the implications of their choices. In terms of the EIA's outlooks compared to the International Energy Agency's outlook, we're actually very similar. When you look at our reference case scenarios compared to the current policy scenario, which are scenarios of the current laws and regulations, not assuming any additional policy changes, we're very similar in terms of total oil use, total global energy use, and so I just wanted to make that point first. In terms of what's happened in the U.S. In the last 5 to 8 years, it's particularly relevant to the discussions here. The advent of shale gas and tight oil have taken us by surprise even. It's often been described as the 20-year overnight success story. It took a very long time of a lot of experimentation by quite small companies exploring and testing technology, developing new technologies, first in the Barnett Shale and drilling horizontal wells and combining that with hydraulic fracturing. And so that's where we first started to see the growth in shale gas. Once that technology had been demonstrated, the number of independent oil and gas companies, which is a key part to the U.S. oil industry, expanded quickly in leasing land. That's a second issue in the U.S. that's really driven the growth in shale gas and tight oil. Landowners typically are also the mineral right owners, and that has given them an incentive to allow for exploration and then development of resources on their property. After the growth in shale gas, companies realized that the same technology could be used for oil, and so as we sit here today, the U.S. is on the verge or slightly past of producing 9 million barrels of oil a day. And that's just crude oil and condensates. We are also producing significant volumes of wet components such as ethane, propane, butane from natural gas wells. All of this, as Ms. Van der Hoven has just pointed out, has made the U.S. Much more secure in terms of its energy resources. However, there's a strong desire within the energy industry to be connected to the international markets. And so you see a lot of discussion within the U.S. about the role of liquefied natural gas exports, LNG exports. The U.S. Department of Energy is involved in granting permission for companies to build facilities. And our agency has recently completed a study of the potential for LNG exports, looking at different scenarios in terms of how quickly the LNG could be exported through 2020. As our study pointed out, we don't see that reaching, I have to think in cubic meters here, so excuse me, but in our highest scenario, it's about 100 billion cubic meters per year. We don't see that happening by 2020, simply from market dynamics. But There is a long-term potential for exports of natural gas in the U.S. Increased natural gas exports from the U.S. Do have an implication for increasing energy prices within the U.S. by relatively small amounts, on the order of 3 to 8%, both for natural gas and for electricity. They also, as the U.S. becomes a larger exporter of natural gas, it will make coal slightly more competitive again, as the U.S. market is a very interconnected, competitive market for all forms of energy. The growth in natural gas has also made nuclear power and renewables have a slightly harder time competing and developing just because of the implications on prices. Just to give you a sense of how much infrastructure is being built in the U.S., just within the eastern part of the United States, in the states of Pennsylvania, West Virginia, Ohio, New York, where the Marcellus Shale and the Utica Shale resources are, in the last 3 months of 2014, roughly, let's see, converting units here, roughly about 3 billion cubic feet per day of new capacity, which is about 35 billion cubic meters per year of capacity, and just pipelines for natural gas are coming online. And that's just in the last 3 months of this year. So infrastructure is being built very quickly, and part of that is the interaction between the state governments and the pipeline companies that are gathering the financing and building that infrastructure. In terms of, and please cut me off when you want, I guess one thing that was brought up was the push for solar distributed generation. And in the U.S., distributed generation has become a very debated topic in the electric power sector because of the reduced need for distribution networks, and the implications is as you increase more distributed generation, that actually reduces the amount of people buying electricity from the market, and thus you have to raise the cost of distributing the remaining amount of electricity. It's been termed the ill health cycle or spiral for the electric power sector, and the U.S. is looking for solutions to increase reliability and security in that sector. And finally, I would say in terms of kind of interesting developments internationally, the reforms that have happened in Mexico in the last year have been very interesting to watch. We have for a long time seen the legislation in Mexico as a real constraint to the development of their substantial resources. And the reforms there are now unlocking those resources. And time will tell how quickly that unfolds. However, there's a very strong interest there for developing their shale gas resources and their oil resources. And we see strong growth in the Mexican energy sector. And that might serve as a template for countries in Europe and around the world in terms of how to make resources competitive on the global scale. So thank you.
Thank you, John. Our next commentator is going to be Livia Vashakova, who is representing the EU Commission in our panel. She has a professional experience of over 10 years in EU institutions, including 8 years in the Directorate General for Energy at the European Commission. As such, she prepared several analyses to support the Commission's documents in the area of internal energy market, renewable energy, energy efficiency, energy infrastructure, and long-term energy strategies. She works currently as economic advisor in the European Commission representation in Slovakia. So, Livia, thank you. The floor is yours.
Dobrý deň.
Vážené dámy, vážení páni, na úvod by som chcela poďakovať pani van den Hoeven. Na úvod by som chcela poďakovať pani van den Hoeven za vynikajúcu prezentáciu, ako aj za výborne pripravený výhľad na ďalších 25 rokov. 8 rokov som pracovala na generálnom riaditeľstve pre energetiku priamo na oddelení, kde sme pripravovali strategické analýzy, kde sa robili energetické scenáre, pripravovali sa dopadové štúdie na rôzne oblasti energetickej politiky. A World Energy Outlook bol pre nás vždy externá publikácia číslo 1, na ktorú sme pozerali. Či už to bolo na globálne trendy, alebo na určitú referenciu voči našim vlastným scenárom, ktoré komisia pravidelne pripravuje a pripravuje ich momentálne do roku 2050. Taktiež by som chcela vyzdvihnúť prácu Medzinárodnej energetickej agentúry a pani van den Hoeven spojenú s propagáciou záverov World Energy Outlook po rôznych svetových hlavných mestách, lebo týmto táto publikácia neostáva iba na akademickej pôde, ale jej závery sa šíria aj medzi politikou, medzi podnikateľský sektor a medzi verejnosť. Práve takýmto spôsobom sa dostáva do pozornosti napríklad nevyhnutnosť boja proti klimatickým zmenám, či zvýšená potreba investícií vzhľadom na budovanie nových kapacít a v prípade Európskej únie aj na obnovu existujúcich kapacít. Čo sa týka záverov v oblasti boja proti klimatickým zmenám, tak ako iste viete, Európska rada na svojom oktobrovom zasadnutí dosiahla dôležitú dohodu na energeticko-klimatickom rámci do roku 2030. Tieto ciele tu už boli dneska spomínané. Ide o záväzný cieľ na zníženie emisií o 40% v porovnaní s rokom 1990. Záväzný cieľ na zvýšenie podielu obnoviteľných zdrojov na úroveň 27% na úrovni Európskej únie a indikatívny cieľ na zvyšovanie energetickej efektívnosti tiež na úrovni Európskej únie na úrovni 27%. Tieto ciele predstavujú jedny z najambicioznejších, ak nie najambicioznejšie, ciele v oblasti boja proti klimatickým zmenám na svete. Z perspektívy Európskej komisie, Európskej únie je táto oktobrová dohoda dôležitým krokom pre uzatvorenie globálnej dohody, ktorá by umožnila dostať sa na trajektóriu zvyšovania teplot maximálne o 2 stupne Celzia. Práve v tejto súvislosti nás tešia nedávne vyhlásenie zo strany Spojených štátov a zo strany Číny, ktoré ukazujú, že tento krok bol správny. Moja druhá poznámka sa bude týkať energetickej efektívnosti. Tak ako Medzinárodná agentúra pre energetiku a Európska komisia vníma zvyšovanie energetickej efektívnosti ako nevyhnutnosť. Som veľmi rada, že v rámci dnešnej konferencie budem mať jeden panel zameraný práve na podporu energetickej efektívnosti na Slovensku v tomto regióne, kde sa tejto téme ešte nedostáva adekvátnej pozornosti. Energetická efektívnosť podporuje dosiahnutie všetkých troch cieľov európskej energetickej politiky, zvyšuje našu energetickú bezpečnosť znižovaním závislosti na dovoze, zvyšuje udržateľnosť a zároveň prispieva k znižovaniu nákladov za energie. Práve to môže byť cesta pre európske podniky na zvýšenie svojej konkurencieschopnosti, keďže ako sme videli pri porovnaní, naše jednotkové ceny elektriny a plynu sú vyššie ako v Spojených štátoch v prípade iných konkurujúcich krajinách. Na energetickú efektívnosť má komisia legislatívny rámec, ktorý zasahuje do budov spotrebičov. Nedávno sa prijala smernica o energetickej efektívnosti, ktorá vytvára aj trhové prostredie na vytvorenie tzv. Služieb energetickej efektívnosti Energy Performance Contracting. Taktiež Európska komisia chce podporovať aj finančne projekty energetickej efektívnosti. V ďalšom programovacom období 2014-2020 sú výrazne vyššie finančné prostriedky vyčlenené práve na podporu energetickej efektívnosti. V situácii Slovenskej republiky tieto prostriedky budú plynúť jednak cez granty, ako aj cez inovatívne finančné nástroje. V rámci Slovenského investičného holdingu sa počíta s využitím prostriedkov aj týmto smerom. V
tejto súvislosti je však dôležité správne nastaviť mechanizmy, aby komerčné financovanie, financovanie cez granty a financovanie cez finančné inštrumenty nešli tým spôsobom, že by vytláčali komerčné subjekty z trhu, ale práve naopak, aby sa navzájom podporovali, aby bolo možné urobiť čo najviac v tejto oblasti. Tretí bodom, ku ktorému sa vyjadrím, je dôraz na investície, ktorý bol špeciálnou témou World Energy Outlook tohto roku. Na úrovni Európskej únie je to momentálne téma číslo 1. Investície sú stále výrazne nižšie v porovnaní s predkrízovým obdobím. Práve tento týždeň by mala Európska komisia rozhodnúť o 300-miliardovom investičnom balíčku. Hovorí sa, že jeho súčasťou bude aj energetika, či už teda projekty v oblasti energetickej infraštruktúry, energetickej efektívnosti, v prípade aj výroby. Zúčastnila som sa nedávneho Tatra summitu, veľkej stredoeurópskej ekonomickej konferencie, kde viacerí zástupcovia energetického podnikateľského sektora vyjadrili názor, že peniaze sú síce nevyhnutné, ale viac ako jednorázová finančná injekcia by bolo potrebné zlepšiť investičné prostredie s dôrazom na stabilný a transparentný regulačný rámec na európskej, ale hlavne na národnej úrovni. Tento rámec by potom stimuloval investície. A práve v tejto súvislosti ma zaujal záver World Energy Outlook ohľadne prehodnotenia fungovania veľkoobchodného trhu s elektrickou energiou v EÚ. V súčasnosti tu máme totiž situáciu, keď veľkoobchodné ceny elektriny klesli na úroveň 30-35 eur za megawatt hodinu, čo len ťažko umožňuje ziskovosť, prípadne nové investície. Na druhej strane tu máme vysoké koncové ceny, ktoré znižujú konkurencieschopnosť európskeho priemyslu voči konkurentom a zároveň zaťažujú naše domácnosti. Tieto nízke veľkoobchodné ceny sú jednak dôsledkom hospodárskej krízy a menšieho objemu ekonomickej aktivity, ako aj napredovaniu pri konvergencii veľkoobchodných cien v dôsledku vytvárania jednotného európskeho trhu, ale svoj vplyv tam majú aj obnoviteľné zdroje, kde napríklad vietor a slnko majú marginálne náklady blízke k nule a to potom znižuje veľkoobchodnú cenu. Tieto veľkoobchodné ceny boli dokonca v niektorých prípadoch negatívne počas tohto roku. Na koncové ceny naopak vplýva hlavne regulovaná zložka ceny, ktorá sa zvyšuje a ktorá v niektorých krajinách je dokonca už vyššia ako komoditná časť ceny. Na záver by som ešte chcela povedať, že energetika je v súčasnosti jednou z najdôležitejších európskych tém. Potvrdzuje to aj fakt, že na inštitucionálnej úrovni máme jedna komisára pre energetiku a klímu, ale vytvorila sa aj nová pozícia podpredsedu Európskej únie pre energetickú úniu, ktorú zastáva pán Šefčovič. Taktiež v rámci veľkého investičného balíčka, o ktorom sa bude tento týždeň rozhodovať, bude energetika zohrávať významnú úlohu. Bolo už viackrát spomenuté, že sa pripravuje politický koncept energetickej únie. Tento bude mať rozhodujúci vplyv nielen na dianie v EÚ, ale si myslím, že výrazne ovplyvní aj globálne trhy a iné regióny. Ďakujem za pozornosť.
Thank you, Livia. It's been extremely interesting, and we're now heading towards the questions section. I'm sure that these comments and the presentation has given rise to many questions for the floor. Before we go into the questions, we have one more important, one very important addition to the panel. Marek Šenković is as chief economic advisor to the CEO at Slovnaft Slovakia and member of the MOL Group since 2006. Has been working and has been responsible for analyzing of industrial and macroeconomic trends that have an impact on the economic performance of the company and analyzing the regional developments. He also represents the company in the board of the directors of the Emergency Oil Stocks Agency of Slovakia. He is author of many expert commentaries in areas of financial markets and the energy sector, and we're very much looking forward to your comments. Marek, the floor is yours.
Ďakujem pekne. Dobrý deň, ctené dámy a páni. V prvom rade vždy s rešpektom A s hlbokou úctou čítame ročné výročné správy Medzinárodnej energetickej agentúry, ale aj mnohé štúdie, ktoré robí energetická agentúra Spojených štátov amerických, ktoré sú veľmi kvalitné a ovplyvňujú európsky energetický sektor možno viac, než by sme si mysleli. Všetky tieto správy sú svojím spôsobom smutné z pohľadu európsko-energetického, energetických podnikov a ja ako zástupca európskej rafinérie tiež asi budem smutný. Dúfam, že nebudete smutní aj vy, tak ako som smutný ja momentálne. Vidíme niekoľko megatrendov, a síce taký, že spotreba energií sa definitívne presúva zo západu na východ, čo bude mať ďalekosiahle dôsledky aj v cenotvorbe na globálnych veľkoobchodných trhoch. Konkrétne to znamená, že pokiaľ dnes o motorovej nafte sa rozhoduje ešte stále z pohľadu ceny, burzovej ceny na burze v Rotterdame, pretože Európa bývala a ešte stále je najväčší spotrebiteľom stredných destilátov vo svete. Pokiaľ v cene automobilov benzínu sa rozhoduje v New Yorku, pretože Spojené štáty americké sú stále ešte najväčším spotrebiteľom benzínu na svete, tak o pár rokov to už tak jednoducho nebude a o týchto cenách sa bude rozhodovať v Singapúre alebo Šanghaji alebo nejakých východoeurópskych burzách. To samozrejme bude mať obrovský tlak na producentov týchto palív v Európe, ale Spojených štátov amerických, ktorí už nebudú market makermi, ale budú market followermi, budú sa musieť prispôsobiť nastaveniu cien z Ázie a tieto ceny môžu byť rôznym spôsobom trhové, ale môžu byť aj pokrivené. Rovnako tak vidíme, že produkcia energií mení svoje doterajšie megatrendy a ekonomická veľmoc, ako sú Spojené štáty americké, sa stávajú mimoriadne silným výrobcom lacnej energie, lacného zemného plynu, lacnej elektrickej energie. A to dáva americkým podnikateľom, americkým firmám obrovský ekonomickú preváhu nad trebárs európskymi alebo japonskými výrobcami. Ja si myslím, že to má dokonca ešte väčší vplyv ako politika nulových úrokových sadzieb, ktoré sa v Spojených štátoch amerických už myslím 6 alebo 7 rokov uplatňuje. Európa je rafinérsky priemysel, ale aj priemysel iných odvetví, ako je napríklad oceliári, metalurgia, cementári, možno aj gumári časom, výroba papiera. To sú sektory, ktoré budú porazeným dňa, to je takého dlhšieho horizontu. A už dneska je vidieť, ako mnohí, keby mali sa rozhodnúť v dnešnej chvíli, či by chceli postaviť závod v Rakúsku, na Slovensku, v Nemecku, alebo v Amerike, tak radšej by si vybrali Severnú Ameriku, Spojené štáty americké, kde ceny plynu, ceny elektriny sú dvojnásobne, niekedy až trojnásobne lacnejšie ako v Európe. Na naše ihriska, ako poviem tak z podnikateľského žargónu, v Európe sa tlačí a valí kvalitná, ale pritom podstatne lacnejšia produkcia zo Spojených štátov amerických vďaka nízkym energetickým vstupom, ale aj kvalitná a tiež lacná produkcia z Ázie, kde nie je to ani tak o lacnej energii, ako o tom, že tie závody sú mnohonásobne väčšie ako ktorékoľvek v Európe a teda jednotkové výrobné náklady sú podstatne nižšie, môžu dosahovať tzv. Economics of scale, jednotkové úspory z nákladov, kde tieto závody často nemusia spĺňať také prísne environmentálne požiadavky, aké sú nastavené v Európe, či lokálnymi vládami alebo aj z Európskej únie, kde je podstatne vlastnejšia pracovná sila a kde mnohé tieto exportné závody sú aj vládami štedro podporované. Aby som to povedal na príklade rafinérskeho priemyslu, doviesť jednu tonu automobilového benzínu z Ameriky alebo z exportnej indickej rafinérie do oblasti Stredozemného mora stojí 20 alebo 30 dolárov na jednu tonu, čo je 3% z burzovej ceny benzínu v Rotterdame, ktorý stojí 1000 dolárov. Je to zhruba toľko isto, keby sme z Bratislavy chceli železnicou exportovať túto tonu z Bratislavy na východné Slovensko, čo je odtiaľto 400 km. To vďaka tomu jednoducho, že tie prepravné tarify námorných tankerov sú extrémne nízke a výrobné náklady aj amerických a ázijských producentov sú tiež výrazne nižšie než európskych konkurentov. To sú trendy, ktoré tu nikdy neboli a ktoré tlačia na Európu, ktorá bola tradičným exportérom rafinérskych produktov minulosti, či do Ameriky, alebo do Afriky, alebo do Ázie, tak dneska jednoducho európsky trh je atakovaný podstatne lacnejším exportom zahraničia myslím si, možno ma kolega z Ameriky opraví, ale neviem, či nie tento rok alebo ďalší rok sa stane to, kedy Spojené štáty americké sa stanú prvýkrát od druhej svetovej vojny čistým exportérom rafinovaných produktov z ropy. Vždy boli dovozcami. Jednoducho, napriek tomu, že spotreba ropy klesla v Amerike, napriek tomu, že by sa mali zatvárať rafinérie, tak sa tomu tak nedieje, ale tomu rozumiem, pretože aj nám by sa ľahšie podnikalo v Amerike. Môžem povedať príklad. V Slovnafte v Bratislave každý rok dáme 120 miliónov eur za nákup zemného plynu. Keby sme tú istú rafinériu mali niekde v strede Ameriky, alebo tam, kde sa ťaží zemný plyn, platili sme 40 miliónov eur. 80 miliónov eur by sme mali buď do zisku, alebo do ďalších investícií, alebo treba aj do toho, aby sme exportovali z Bratislavy, ja neviem kam, na aký trh vo svete. Takže to sú trendy, ktoré tu neboli a ktoré tu sú a ktoré sa nezmenia. Vidíme tiež, že zemný plyn úplne zmenil mapu ropného trhu. V minulosti zemný plyn bola alternatíva voči vykurovacím olejom, ktoré sa vyrábajú z ropy. Dneska zemný plyn sa stáva v podobe stlačeného zemného plynu, skvapalneného zemného plynu, palivom pre ťažkú dopravu, nákladné automobily, v budúcnosti lode. Dneska zo zemného plynu, respektíve z etánu, ktorý sa často ťaží pri tých veľkých náleziskách zemného plynu, dajú vyrábať plasty, ako je polietylén, to znamená plast, ktorý tuto bežne vidíte okolo seba, niekoľkonásobne lacnejšie ako ten istý polietylén z ropy. Európa, keďže nemá zemného plynu dostatok, Amerika ho má, tak samozrejme všetci petrochemickí producenti by radšej podnikli, aj budú podnikať v Amerike. A ten polietylén sa nebude vyrábať v Európe, ale bude sa dovážať. A rovnako tak vidíme, ako je príklad plynové elektrárne v Katare, že sa zo zemného plynu dá dneska vyrobiť motorový a naftomotorový benzín. Tie výrobné náklady sú podstatne rádovo nižšie ako vyrobenie nafty z ropy. Investičné náklady na stavbu také rafinérie sú vyššie, ale keď to vláda zaplatí v Katare, tak ten podnikateľ je rád, samozrejme. Takže vidíme tu takýto game changer v podobe zemného plynu, ktorý ovplyvňuje ropný priemysel, ktorý aj bude ovplyvňovať do budúcnosti. Vidíme tiež niekoľko megatrendov, ktoré sú, niektoré z nich sú prirodzené, a síce ako nárast, signifikantný nárast úspornosti spotrebičov alebo aj automobilov, kde každý nový rok, čo vyjde nový automobil, nový model, znamená o 2, o 3% vyššiu úspornosť. To je prirodzený vývoj. Vidíme generačné zmeny, kde v Európe populácia nerastie, skôr stagnuje, objem možno bude klesať v budúcnosti, kde starne, staršia populácia má iné preferencie v doprave ako mladá, aktívna, produktívna populácia. Vidíme, že absolútny počet automobilov v Európe nemá potenciál narastať, keďže ani nerastie populácia a keďže už dnes každý dospelý človek, myslím, v tej vyspelej časti západnej Európy má auto, nepotrebuje dva, respektíve nedokáže naraz taký človek riadiť dva automobily. Vidíme, že biopalivá, ktoré boli nariadené z Európskej únie niekedy pred 10 rokmi, dnes ukrajujú stále väčšie a väčšie percento z trhu ropných produktov. Ono sa zdá, že 5% biozložek, ktoré sa dnes povinne primiešavajú a v roku 2020 majú 10%, ak sa to nezmení, a dúfam, že sa to zmení teda, tak jednoducho, že to je málo, ale je to veľa, pretože rafinériu, keď postavíte, tak technologické minimá pre spracovanie ropy, pre vôbec, aby tie destilačné jednotky vedeli fungovať, ktoré tú ropu spracúvajú, musia ísť aspoň na, a sa to líši od rafinérie k rafinérie, od 70 po 85%. To znamená, každé 1%, čo zoberie z výkonu rafinérie nejaký alternatívny produkt, môže znamenať to, že prídeme po istú úroveň, kde tú rafinériu musíme úplne odstaviť, pretože už sa tie chemicko-fyzikálne procesy tam jednoducho nenabehnú. Vidíme, že postupnú penetráciu, zatiaľ malú, majú aj elektromobily, ale od 20 do 30 rokov to bude zrejme z jeden veľmi silných megatrendov, čo tiež vnímam normálne ako prirodzený vývoj. Vidíme, že rozvíjajú sa nové služby, ako napríklad car sharing, ktorá znamená to, že vlastniť automobil už dneska nie je tak taká statusová záležitosť, ako bola možno pred 10, 20, 30 rokmi. A teda aj tie autá sa podstatne viac efektívnejšie využívajú, čo samozrejme zase bude znižovať nejaké náklady pre prepravu. Vidíme tiež, že tie najvyspelejšie krajiny, najvyspelejšie mesta, lokálne vlády podporujú tzv. Koncepty kompaktných miest, aby boli radšej menšie, vyššie, aby ľudia menej cestovali a cestovali nejakou mestskou hromadnou dopravou. Samozrejme, teraz ma obviníte, že vlastne mám záujem, aby to bolo čo najviac závod a tak ďalej, to mi jasné. Ja len naznačím, že to je trend, voči ktorému ani nebojujem, vnímam ho a proste je to prirodzený vývin. Ale okrem takýchto prirodzených trendov vidíme aj mnohé umelé opatrenia, ktoré si sami ako Európania dávame a ktoré sa kladú na nielen rafinérsky priemysel, ale aj na iné energeticky intenzívne odvetvia, ktoré sú rôzne skryté a infikujú napríklad to, že priemyselní podnikatelia v prípade Slovenska, už to bolo povedané, musia platiť výrazne vyššie ceny elektrické energie z toho titulu, že musia v podstate priamo dotovať tých výrobcov elektrické energie, ktorí vyrábajú zo slnka alebo vetra. Alebo že je tu nejaký systém emisných povoleniek, ktoré na niektoré sektory môže dopadnúť veľmi kriticky, aj keď teraz cena emisných povolení je veľmi nízka, ale keby bola na tej projektovanej úrovni, ako bolo voľa, keď plánovaná, že 20 eur za jednu tonu oxidu uhličitého, tak to je bolo úplne likvidačné. Vidíme tiež sprísňujúce sa požiadavky v oblasti rôznych environmentálnych podmienok, ktoré sú fajn, samozrejme, pretože bavíme sa o klíme a o živote, ale pokiaľ to iní producenti vo svete nerobia, tak je to problém pre Európu. A problém je v tom, že európske podniky nevyriešia globálny problém s emisiami. Neviem, v ktorej prezentácii som to už videl, ale Európa stále tvorí najviac HDP na svete. Je to veľmi zaujímavý, likvidný, bohatý trh, 500 miliónov ľudí tu žije, ale podiel emisí na globálnych emisiách je menej ako 10%, myslím, že 8 alebo nejak tak, alebo 11. Ale je to určite menej ako v Číne, určite menej ako Spojených štátov amerických. A pokiaľ mi neveríte, tak jedno číslo poviem. V Európe žije 500 miliónov ľudí, spotreba ropy je 13 miliónov barelov ropy denne. Spojených štátov amerických žije, neviem, 320 miliónov ľudí, možno tak. A spotreba ropy je 17 miliónov barelov. Vlastne vidíte ten nepomer už len pri dope. Je to samozrejme otázka zdanenia a ceny tých komodít v Európe, ktoré sú násobne drahšie ako v Amerike. Takže to sú také opatrenia, také reštrikcie, ktoré či centrálna úroveň z Bruselu alebo lokálne vlády zaťažili európsky priemysel, ktoré povedú k tomu, že mnohé odvetvia, ktoré celkom prirodzene budú musieť skôr či neskôr umrieť alebo zaniknúť, tak k tomu zániku dojde skôr. A tie investície, ktoré boli do nich vložené, sa nikdy nesplatia, budú zmarené, vyhodené peniaze. Rovnako tak vidím to, že Európa ako sama nemôže zmeniť globálny problém s emisiami, pretože ten problém sa len presunie inám. Tá výroba, ktorá z Európy odíde, tak pôjde do Číny, alebo do Ameriky, alebo do Indie, ale v globálnom meritku je rovnaká. A z Európy sa stane exporter, ale importer. Ďalším efektom z takýchto opatrení býva to, že štátom vypadávajú daňové príjmy, že zamestnanosť nebude rásť. Samozrejme, a to, čo je, keď sa bavíme o budúcnosti, problém to, že mladí ľudia aj strácajú záujem študovať také technické predmety, ktoré ešte dneska ako tak žijú, ale o 20-30 rokov už žiť nebudú. Sami chodíme po technických univerzitách, hľadáme inžinierov, ktorí by chceli pracovať v našej rafinérii, ponúkajú dobrý plat, dobré miesto, technologický rozvoj a tak ďalej, ale keď povedia, no o 20 rokov vaša rafinéria ešte bude existovať, ja hovorím, no naša bude, ale 25 rafinérie z Európy už nebude. No a čo keď aj vaša nebude, tak je odpoveď, no budeme, stále im hovorím, že budeme, my budeme ešte stále. Jednoducho, podobný problém určite majú aj inžinieri jadrovej energetiky v Nemecku, ktoré chce odísť zo tohto sektora a tým pádom tí študenti tento vysoko sofistikovaný, náročný sektor nechcú študovať, lebo nemajú, nebudú mať perspektívu. Rovnako tá hutníctvo, ťažké strojárstvo, to sú odvetvia, ktoré ľudia nechcú študovať, pretože nevidia tam perspektívu v Európe. Aby som povedal konkrétny trebárs, v našom rafinérskom biznise, my ako Slovnaft, ročne zaplatíme zhruba 25 miliónov eur tak nákladov v cene elektrickej energie, pričom tých 25 miliónov odíde tým, ktorí si postavili fotovoltaické, veterné a biomasové elektrárne. Pred 5 rokmi to bolo 5 miliónov, čiže máme 5-násobne vyšší náklad. Žiaden benefit z toho, my ako rafinéria. Tých 25 miliónov je skoro to isté, čo je náš ročný zisk, ktorý by sme mohli použiť na niečo iné. Platíme zhruba 20% zo všetkých nákladov, ak dáme nabok ropu, z tých ostatných zvyšných nákladov, čiže 200 miliónov eur ročne za to, že musíme nakupovať biozložky a primiešavať ich povinne do nafty a benzínu, pričom tie biozložky nie sú ani lacnejšie. A ak tie mnohé štúdie, ktoré už boli na svete, ktoré už sú na svete, aj myslím, že z Európskej únie, hovoria o tom, že nie sú ani ekologické, tak ten zmysel nevidím. Ale to je jednoducho 200 miliónov, ktoré rafinéria musí platiť a rafinérie v Európe je 100. Takže je to náklad enormný. Vidíme, ako keď nám odchádza generácia starých chemikov a inžinierov, že ich nevieme nájsť na trhu. Keď ich chcete nájsť, tak ich musíte preťahnuť z druhej rafinérie za dvojnásobný, trojnásobný plat. Aj to len na krátku dobu, pretože cítia, že o 10 rokov proste ten biznis bude oveľa, oveľa horší. Vidíme, ako do Európy sa valí jedno kargo za druhým, z Ameriky alebo z Blízkeho východu, alebo už z tej Indie. A vidia, že tá Európa je bohatý kontinent. Ľudia platia, spotrebiteľa platia na čas a vidia tú ochromenú domácu produkciu. Obry, ktorí proste dneska stoja už len na hlinených nohách. Tak ako my máme v Slovnafte projekty za stovky miliónov eur a iné rafinérie za podobné, stovky miliónov eur, ktoré by mohli, keby sa investovali, zužitkovať ropu ešte viac, ako sa dnes dá, je to o energetickej efektívnosti, pretože dnes z tony ropy alebo z barov ropy nezískate 100% produktov. Je tam odpad, vykurovacie oleje, asfalty, síra, proste produkty, ktoré sa predávajú za podstatne nižšiu cenu, ako je cena ropy. Tak, a nedajú sa už ani predať, pretože dopyt po týchto produktoch není. Tak toto, tieto produkty vieme odstrániť tým, že by sme ich konvertovali na naftu, na benzín. Ale na to potrebujete ďalšie špeciálne krakovacie jednotky, ktoré stoja stovky miliónov eur. A teraz si povieme, no dáme do toho, aby sme znížili produkciu takýchto výrob o 2, o 3, o 5 % a aj prispeli tým vlastne environmentu v konečnom dôsledku. Alebo nedáme. Pri normálnom trhovom vývoji, kedy ceny fluktujú normálnym spôsobom, tak sa vám to vráti za 15 rokov. Ale pri normálnom vývoji, respektíve, pardon, pri pokrivenom vývoji, aký nastane, sa vám tá investícia nevráti nikdy. A jednoducho tie rafinérie takéto opatrenia ani nespravia. Vidíme, že 15% rafinérie v Európe už skončilo, definitívne. A ďalších 25% aj v súlade s tým, čo pani reprezentantka z IEA povedala, skončí. Spotreba ropy dneska je na úrovni okolo 13 miliónov barelov, o roku 2040 bude 8,5 milióna barelov ropy denne. Takže to je jasné, že ten priestor sa sem zmenší. Takže v tomto zmysle môžem povedať to, že viacerým odvetviam v Európe hrozí zánik. A je to, pokiaľ je to prirodzené, tak ako v 19. storočí, keď sa chcelo svietiť na uliciach alebo domoch, tak sa používal rybí olej, potom sa používal olej z ropy, potom v 20. storočí to boli žiarovky a dneska trh zaplavili LED diody. Tak to bol normálny technologický vývoj, ktorý proste bol prirodzený, tak ako ľudstvo zmudrelo. A samozrejme, pokiaľ tieto zmeny a zániky odvetví sú vynucované násilne, možno až, tak je to extrémne nákladné. A je to aj nespravodlivé, a myslím si, že je to nepoctivé, nielen voči majiteľom rafinérií, alebo voči investorom, voči bankám, ktorí možno niektoré úvery v budúcnosti sa nesplatia z tých investícií. Je to nepoctivé voči spotrebiteľom, ktorí ani nevedia, že vlastne nepriamo treba v cene tých ropných produktov alebo železa alebo neviem čoho platia to, aby sa podporil nejaký iný sektor, treba z obnoviteľné zdroje. A je to nepoctivé samozrejme aj voči tým ľuďom, ktorí v týchto tradičných odvetviach pracujú, lebo o 10 rokov tam možno už pracovať nebudú. Ďakujem pekne zatiaľ.
Thank you, Marek, very much for these very interesting insights. And now the floor is open to questions. I would like to ask everybody who is asking a question to speak into the microphone and to identify themselves with their institutions. There is one question right to start with on my left. Yes.
Thank you. I have a question for Maria van der Hoven. From the commercial and technical standpoint, Iran and countries of Caspian region can replace Russia as the major supplier of gas to Europe. I wonder if the agency has considered such a scenario.
Did I understand you correctly? Iran and Caspian region?
Right. Iran is the leading country in terms of gas reserves. Russia is number two. And I think Turkmenistan is number three. So two of them, just Iran and Turkmenistan, have a lot of gas reserve to supply all neighboring countries. And geographically, Iran and Turkmenistan are closer to European markets than West Siberia.
In our assumptions, we use all the policies that are either in place or being announced. And as far as I know, the policy on Iran at this moment, as long as there is not a deal on nuclear, there's no policy there that I can use as an assumption. I'm sorry. And the same goes for the Caspian region, where we can see now that they are looking eastwards. Kazakhstan is looking eastwards, and Turkmenistan is looking eastwards, building pipelines to China. And it's not only in oil, but it's also in gas. So I think it's important that we take into account what's happening, and that those are our assumptions. The moment policy changes, we can change the assumptions, and then the outcome of our scenarios will be different. And that's why I mentioned in the very beginning that this book, well, I've just got a summary here, it's not a Bible. It's not. And it's not a prediction. It's not a forecast. It is a, there are three scenarios how the world might look like if we take into account everything that is in place now and policies that are announced nowadays. But the moment they change, for instance, having a nuclear deal with Iran, that might change. But even then, it will take quite a few time before everything in Iran is up and running again, and that is because it has been running idle, it has been stand idle for quite a few years. But we always have a very, very keen and open eye for what is happening, and if things happen, we take them into account. I would like to mention one thing else. This is a long-term projection. It's 2040. Interesting from a midterm projection is our 5 years annual market report. And we present our annual market report on oil next year in spring, and on gas it will be in summer. And there we take into account a 5 years horizon, which is of course much different than a 25 years horizon.
Thank you. We have one question also here in the back. If you can identify yourself, we would appreciate it. Thank you.
I'm Ákos Böti with the Regional Center for Energy Policy Research of Hungary. And I would like to ask Ms. Van der Hoven if the International Energy Agency has any concerns about safety issues in China with regards to the huge nuclear capacity development that you showed us. Can you reassure us that nuclear safety standards in China are as rigorous as in the EU, for example, and if they are actually met? And my other question would go to Mr. Staub. Is the US interested in facilitating or even encouraging LNG exports to Central Eastern Europe in particular in order to help them become less dependent on Russian gas, which is a U.S. geopolitical interest as well. Thank you.
Of course, IEA is not the Atomic Energy Agency. We are an international energy agency. When we look into the nuclear situation in China, there are two things I would like to mention in answer to your question. First of all, it's about the safety issues and the concerns. What we can see in China, that there is a public debate, even in China, on nuclear. But on the other hand, the safety concerns and the safety regulations, well, they need to be the same everywhere. The second thing I would like to mention is about China, is that they have developed a new generation type of reactors. And that's interesting because it would also mean that China is not only to be the largest generator of nuclear power, but it will also mean that it might be export some kind of technologies that at this moment are quite interesting for other parts of the world, but are not in use in other parts of the world. What do I mean by that? I mean by this that we have to take it to bear in mind that the position of China is going to change. It's going to change not only because it's the biggest energy, it has the biggest growth in energy demand, but also because of this development in nuclear. And the third issue, China is a country that is extremely interested in having new contacts with the Western part of the world, with the OECD countries. And this is something we have to take into account as well. And China, when you look into the market conditions there, it's together with the United States, they are the two biggest economies. They are the two biggest emitters of CO2 emissions. So that's why, in our view, it's absolutely important not only to look at the OECD countries, but also to look beyond the OECD countries, especially to China. So my answer goes a bit beyond your question about nuclear, but it shows, I think, that we have a very, very keen interest in exactly monitoring what there is in China and find more than one way to engage with them on different kind of energy issues.
Thank you. John?
And just following upon that, the first new nuclear power plant being built in the U.S. is of the same technology that's being built in China. And the idea there is to learn from the work that they're doing so that there's pushing the learning curve faster. In terms of the question about U.S. policy, as I said earlier, the EIA is not involved in policy. One of my colleagues from the U.S. State Department would probably be better able to answer your question. I can say, though, that in terms of the development of LNG export facilities in the U.S., the companies that are building their facilities first are lining up contracts that cover the cost of building these facilities. And that is, they're essentially giving the risk to the consumers who will eventually buy the gas. And at this time, that's kind of the main model that's being approached. As more and more facilities are built, there may be companies that are willing to take on or have to take on more risk themselves. Hope that's helpful.
Thank you. One question also on the left.
Hello, everybody. My name is Milan Nidža. I'm director of a think tank, CEPI, Central European Policy Institute, based here in Bratislava. I was struck by presentation or several comments and remarks by Mr. Senković on the plight of the refineries and oil industry in Europe in general and in this region in particular. I think it was a very good presentation and very open assessment. But I wonder what it means for this region with so many refineries in a small place around. MOL is not only the is not the only big player here. We have Austria, we have Czech Republic, we have Croatia all around. What is your projection for the next 5 years for the region? And what is the time horizon where you see first refineries, you don't indicate who, but would be closing? And the second question about the LNG market in Europe. Where do you see development of LNG facilities in Europe matured enough and enough entry points being in place technically, that this will be interesting market globally in Europe for global suppliers like US. Thank you.
Marek?
Ďakujem pekne. Ako som už naznačil, v Európe je asi 100 rafinérií, ktoré sú stále v prevádzke. Bolo ich zhruba 115. Tie najmenšie, ktoré sú aj najstaršie a nevedia dosiahnuť také ekonomické úspory z rozsahu výroby, už boli zavreté. Úplne najbližšia rafinéria k Slovensku, ktorá bola zavretá, bola v Pardubiciach v Českej republike nedávno, myslím, rok alebo dva roky dozadu. Ale podobný osud stihli mnohé talianske, francúzske, nemecké rafinérie a určite sa to stane aj v regióne východnej Európy. Nemyslím si, že sa to stane na Slovensku, pretože bez toho, že by som sa chcel chváliť alebo našu rafinériu, ale rafinéria má veľmi dobrú štruktúru produkcie, ktorá nás stála miliardu dolárov zhruba pred 15 rokmi, čo iné rafinérie neurobili. A teda vďaka tomu máme oveľa väčší podiel takých produktov, ktoré sú zisku. Takže my, ak budeme zhasiť na to svetlo, tak budeme ako poslední, ak to tak môžem povedať. Ale je pravda, že aj na Balkáne sú rafinérie, ktoré sú malé, staré, a kde trh je dobíjaný tými kargami, tými dodávkami palív, či z Blízkeho východu, alebo možno aj z Ameriky, a jednoducho nemajú šancu prežiť. Takže budú zavreté. A ten vývoj je asi taký, že, a verím tomu, čo vlastne aj IEA tvrdí, tá spotreba ropy v Európe klesne z 13 miliónov barelov ropy spotrebované denne na 8,5 do roku 2040. Takže o takú istú mieru sa musia znížiť aj rafinačné kapacity v Európe. Otázne je, kde. Samozrejme, vlády budú bojovať medzi sebou, pretože pre každú vládu, pre každého premiéra alebo premiérku je problematické zavrieť rafinériu doma, pretože nedá sa to vlastne vysvetliť domácim spotrebiteľom, že tie palivá sa dajú kúpiť niekde na susednom trhu. Pretože bavíme sa, a v tejto dobe je to zvlášť citlivé, o bezpečnosti, o energetickej bezpečnosti, o energetickej sebestačnosti. Chceme tu vytvoriť Európsku úniu, aby sme celých 500 miliónov ľudí rozmýšľali ako keby jeden blok, jeden štát, ale v skutočnosti stále sme 28 rozdielnych krajín. A myslím si, že to ešte niekoľko desiatok rokov aj tak potrvá. Proste tá zmena musí prísť znútra, to ľudia musia cítiť, že Slováka zaujímajú španielské problémy a Španiel zaujímajú poľské problémy alebo litovské. A teraz bez toho, že by som hovoril ako o nejakých národoch, ale toto jednoducho ešte v sebe nemáme. A pokiaľ táto solidarita medzi krajinami je, na papier je, v ideách je, v koncepte je, ale v skutočnom ponímaní není, tak jednoducho každý si bude strážiť ten svoj energetický sektor. Či to je rafinérsky, či to je elektrické energie, plynový sektor. Takže z tohto pohľadu tu mnoho neefektívnosti v tejto Európe sa udeje, pretože keď si každý bude chcieť postaviť svoju atomovú elektrárňu pre svoj trh, svoju rafinériu pre svoj trh, tak je to vždy drahšie, ako keby ste postavili jednu veľkú atomovú elektrárňu, jednu veľkú rafinériu pre vás pre dve, tri krajiny. Takže to sú tie náklady, ktoré vlastne platíme zbytočne v konečnom dôsledku. A nevieme čeliť indickej rafinérii, najmodernejšej, napríklad jednej, ktorá dneska dokáže za deň spracovať milión barelov ropy denne, a taký Slovnaft, ktorá je štandardná európska rafinéria, spracuje 100 000 barelov, 10-krát menej. Tak samozrejme, že tie výrobné náklady aj v tom Slovnafte alebo aj v iných rafinériách sú podstatne vyššie na jednotku produkcie ako v tej Indii. A neviem, či ste ohľadne LNG chceli sa pýtať mňa alebo kolegov, ale len poviem jeden koment k zemnému plynu. My sme po tej plynových krízach v roku 2007 a 2009 vlastne zistili ako v rafinérii, že pre nás je ešte väčší problém nemať plyn ako ropu. Pretože na ropu, nedostatok ropy, sú krajiny pomerne dobre vybavené. Každá krajina viac či menej má nejaké strategické zásoby ropy, okrem toho sú ešte komerčné zásoby v rafinériách. A jednoducho, je tam nejaká obdobie, mesiaca, dvoch, troch, možno až pol roka, kedy tie štáty vedia žiť aj bez dodávok ropy. A navyše potom sa dá tá ropa doviesť z iných kútov sveta. Ten pretlak, ako povedala pani riaditeľka z IEA, na trhu je obrovský. Dneska to vidíme na cenách ropy, ktoré sú o 20-30 dolárov nižšie, ako boli pred rokom. Ale plyn je teraz pre takú rafinériu oveľa citlivejší. Tam zásobníky nie sú a keď nemáte plyn, nemôžete napríklad vyrobiť vodík. Keď nemôžete vyrobiť vodík, nemôžete odsíriť motorové paliva, nemôžete ich predať na trhu. A jednoducho my sme zistili, že keď sa odstavili vtedy dodávky plynu na Slovensko, tak my by sme museli rafinériu odstaviť zo dňa na deň. A teraz taký Slovnaft nebol odstavený nikdy vo svojej histórii. Posledných 60 rokov nebol jeden jediný deň, keby tá rafinéria bola odstavená. Takže my nemáme skúsenosť, že keby sa vypla treba z dôvodu nedostatku elektrického prúdu alebo plynu, že ako by sme ju zapli späť, lebo tí ľudia, ktorí ju vtedy zapli, už nežijú. A tí, čo žijú, vlastne majú len teoretické znalosti. Ďakujem pekne.
Thank you. If I may abuse this position to insert just one question to Maria van der Hoef and to profit from her presence here. I was very interested in the remark that the World Energy Outlook predicts a 60% increase in nuclear capacity in the given time perspective, but doesn't envisage a nuclear renaissance. And it's understandable, and you explained why, and it's all very clear. I was just wondering, on one hand, whether you see some of the technologies that we hear about that can produce a fundamental reform or transformation of the nuclear technology in this particular period probably taking shape, whether that can act as a game changer and make it into a renaissance in the overall, in this time perspective. And most importantly, I would very much be interested in your recommendations for the Paris 2015 summit. What you would recommend for the member states that will participate, what paths to follow, what priorities to name.
Well, about nuclear, what I mentioned in my introduction is that many people underestimate the power of nuclear when it comes down to energy security and to the climate results. 4 years of emissions at current level, it's quite a lot, you know, it's quite a lot. If that could be done in 2040, that already underlines the importance of nuclear. But of course, as you mentioned, the development in nuclear has to move on, and we do hope that, for instance, in a couple of years, there will be a significant progress in the new nuclear, more modular-like approach that will certainly help also in the smaller economies. Your second question about Paris, I would like to mention that we have Lima first. It's COP Lima. And I think what happens in Lima will really pave the way for Paris. So I hope that in Lima a number of issues will already been addressed. One of them, of course, has to do with energy. Energy and energy-related infrastructure is responsible for more than two-thirds of the CO2 emissions. And that has to be taken into account. So you cannot find a problem, you cannot find a solution for the climate problem without taking energy into account. And if you don't do that, well, you might be in a problem with your energy supply. So it's absolutely vital that these two sectors, climate and energy, are really in this together and that they find solutions together, because otherwise the lights will go out and nobody's waiting for that. This year, last year we produced our climate report, and we had four points I would like to mention now from an energy perspective that could help to reduce the CO2 emissions and could bring us closer to this 2 degrees Celsius target. First of all, stop flaring methane. It's something that is still happening. And when you look at a picture by night of the United States, you can see a lot of light in places where there are no cities at all, because they are flaring methane. Stop doing that. It's one thing. The other thing is, see to it that you stop your subcritical coal-fired power plants. There are still a lot of subcritical coal-fired power plants, not in our parts of the world, but they are in countries like India. Invest in supercritical fired power plants and help them to see to it that you change this character of the power plants. The second thing was phase out fossil fuel subsidies, because fossil fuel subsidies, they keep prices artificially low and they encourage wasteful consumption. And the fourth one is, please have a better look at what energy efficiency can bring you, not only in cost effectiveness, but also in reducing the fossils you use. It has its influence on energy security, on lowering your import bills, etc. This is what we have been doing in the past year. We are working on this right now, and when we are preparing our next climate report to be launched in early next year. For Lima, we are again putting emphasis on these messages, but also on something else. Sometimes, you know, I have the impression, not here, but in other parts of the world, that people are not really interested in the climate anymore. They are getting a bit tired of it. So, well, okay, it will happen. That's bad. So when you turn it around, and when you try to understand that people are interested in a number of issues, to reduce costs, to reduce energy dependency, to, for instance, have a car that is fuel efficient, to have a better air quality, and things like that, approach it from that side. And then you can have a number of issues that have climate effects as well. So that is what we are going to work on now. Approach it from a different angle, without forgetting about the climate, but not only talking about the climate, because sometimes people are a little bit tired of that. It's not right, but it's what's happening. Then my third remark is about the resilience of energy infrastructure, and that's something I'm very worried about. You know, when in Japan there was the tsunami, and then the accidents and the incidents at Fukushima Daiichi, when there was the Hurricane Sandy in the United States, what happened afterwards? There was a kind of cascade of events and a cascade of decision-making procedures. But as people were not really prepared to do that, they sometimes really didn't know what was happening. Because in the United States, for instance, they discovered that they had quite some problems with the supply of gasoline. And another thing was that if you build your spare generator on your fourth or your fifth floor, but when you don't have electricity, you have to carry the fuel upstairs by buckets. So things like that, they are very simple. And the same things happened in Japan, where because there was no real knowledge of how to deal with these kind of emergencies and disasters, you had a cascade of events. So my point is, how resilient is our energy infrastructure, and how well prepared are our people? And in that case, I would like to stress the enormous importance of human resources. If you don't have the people who can deal with it, if you don't have the real experts who deal with it, they have to look into the books. Well, and before they have found the books, the accidents happened. So that isn't very helpful. So these are the kind of practical issues that we are working on at this moment. But this resilience of energy infrastructure, those were two events. But of course, there's also something else. What about when cooling water is getting into a different temperature? And then you have to shut down your nuclear reactors because your cooling water can't cope with the cooling efficiency, the cooling needs, things like that. We have to think about the energy resilience of our energy infrastructure as well. And it all is related to climate. It's all related to climate. And that's why I think it's important that we look into the energy aspects, deal with them, and have the climate aspects as well in our minds. And maybe that's a kind of different approach, but at the end, it might engage the public better, it will see that the funds are available, and more important, will be more effective.
Thank you. Absolutely. I think we have time for one more question, if there is an issue to be raised yet. Where we have, exhausted the panel and exhausted the topic for the moment. And we have been given a very thorough and a profound analysis and approaches to these issues. Well, if so, then we would like to ask audience to thank me and for the panel speakers and the presentation of this morning. And we very much appreciate your comments and insights. So thank you very much.
Thank you.